Hello, this is the second lesson of our composition workshop. We are going to talk about three considerations for sonority. There are, of course, many more things we should consider in creating sonority, but I picked the most significant three considerations for sonority and I will demonstrate them. What are these considerations? Dynamic, octave, register, and instrumentation. The same sonority. Let's say this is the same chord. We can change the effect of this chord only by changing its dynamic. If you play the chord piano, it has a different effect. If you play it in fortissimo dynamic, then it has a completely different effect and different musical meaning. We can change the octave register, we can transpose the chord, or we can transpose part of the chord, we can split it to different octave registers, and then we have a completely different sonority. I gave some examples of this praxis in the first lesson. So we can change the instrumentation of the chord, and then each time we have maybe, according to the difference in the instrumentation, we have every time a completely different chord. Let's say flute plays this, and trumpet plays this, and violoncello, and then here, bass clarinet. And if you change it, instead of flute, I take trumpet here, and then here I take violas, and here trombone, and here violoncello and double bass. These chords will sound maybe completely differently. Here we have a very simple sonority, a very simple chord. Consisting of three tones. And now we are going to hear it in eight different dynamic levels. It will begin in pianissimo and the dynamic will increase gradually. Let's listen to it. In my opinion, it is, of course, a subjective perception. In my opinion, this sound works very well in lower dynamics until maybe that point. But beginning at that point, the sound, the chord lose its character. And at the end, it will sound disturbing for my ears. For me, it is a sound that works in quiet dynamic. So let's listen to it again. It is definitely not a forte sound. It doesn't belong to the forte dynamic for my ears. Another example, a similar example, but the sound is different. Instead of, I picked a more dissonant sound. Let's listen to it, and this sound works, in my opinion, both in quiet dynamic and also in the loud dynamic. If your perception is similar to mine, you will hear that it works also in the loud dynamic. Let's listen to it. It doesn't sound artificial here. It sounds very natural. The sound belongs to that dynamic level. But the previous one, in my opinion, this is artificial. Artificial. It is forced. It is not natural. So, this is about dynamic. We should listen to the sound. We should listen to what dynamic, which dynamic the sound wants. Of course, if you write forte, we can play everything forte, but the question is, if the sound wants to be played forte, or if the sound wants to be played maybe pianissimo. So this is a thing that we should consider in writing a song. Another consideration is octave register. I pick the first sound, the first chord, and made some experiments through octave transpositions. Let's listen to the sounds. And you see, it sounds every time different, although we have exactly the same pitches, same three pitches, through octave transpositions, through octave placements, we get each time a different sound. We can do the same also with the other chord, with a more dissonant chord. Let's listen to it. In my opinion, the difference in these versions is more dramatic. We have much more difference between the sounds, between different constellations. So, and then orchestration. This is a work by Alban Berg, Altenberg Lieder, 5 Orchestral Songs, Opus 4, number 3. Let's listen to the beginning. This is the beginning. You are going to hear 5 chords. So, let's listen to it, then we are going to talk about it. I showed the chords already. We hear 5 times, 5 chords. I hesitated a little bit because I was not sure what I should say, 5 different chords or 5 times the same chord. If you look at the piano transcription, as you probably know, every vocal work in the classical music has a piano transcription so that the vocalist could practice it. So if you look at the piano transcription, you will see exactly the same sound. 5 times exactly the same sound. So let's listen to it by looking at the chords. You will see how different the chord each time sounds. what the cause of this difference is the instrumentation. The chord has been instrumented every time differently. Apart from that, the chord has also a special construction. In general, if the focus of the music on a particular chord, this chord has to have a characteristic, a reason why the composer chose that chord. Such chords in the literature have mostly a significant feature. Let's examine the structure of this chord. I wrote it this way so that we can see it more clearly. You can pause the video at this moment and think about the construction of the chord. Try to find a construction principle for that chord. The chord is based on these intervals. It begins with a major 7, and the intervals are getting gradually smaller. And the last one is the smallest interval that we can have in our equal tempered system. So the largest interval within one octave and the smallest interval, and a gradual decrease of the intervals. And what is the connection between these intervals and the chord here, the construction of the chord? In my opinion, this is what I think. There could be also other ways to explain this construction, but I find my way pretty convincing. In my opinion, Alban Berg begins with this one, with the smallest intervals we have in our system, and put it here. So, and then comes the next interval. It is here. Why? The first one, the beginning point, is not especially important because we have to begin somewhere. It doesn't have to have a reason, but the important part is the connection between elements. If you begin here, okay, begin anywhere you want, but if you put another element, but in this context, it has to have some reason. So, in this case, Berg follows the following principle. He puts this interval below the first one. Considering the top one, the upper one, he looks the next possible F sharp here. The next possible F sharp below the first interval, it is here, and he puts the interval here. Then you can guess this one will come next. Where is the next G natural? It is here. So then he puts the interval here, and then this will come next. Where is the next G sharp? It is here, and he puts the interval here. Meets a more beautiful graphic. This is the construction from high to low. And then what are the other pitches here? We have four more pitches. We have this one, you will see it is here. A sharp goes to here, and B natural comes to here. So why this interval comes to this place? In my opinion, the reason is because of the gap. By putting this interval to this place and this into this octave register and this one to this octave register, we have a large gap here, a minor seventh. Then he fills this gap with this interval, and he divides this interval into two. One of them goes here and fills the gap here, and the other one goes to the top. We have also here a symmetrical construction. the yellow one is in the middle, and the blue ones, then comes the red ones, and then comes the blue ones. We have also a symmetrical, more or less a symmetrical construction here. So this is my explanation. It is, I find it pretty convincing. It is not one-to-one. It doesn't explain everything, but it is, if you are familiar with Altenberg's music, you also know that it is mostly not possible to make a precise explanation of the material. It is a fascinating feature of his music. He finds a balance between structural working and personal musical decisions. Let's listen to it once again. Thank you for watching and see you in the next lesson.